CDNA. Dr. Locke.
Thank you very much. So I was given this very ambitious title. I'm not sure that at this stage in 2018, we have those treatment options that will allow us to eradicate cccDNA yet. But let's talk about what might be coming down the pipeline. So these are my disclosures. You all know that these are the treatments that we have available right now. Interferon and the oral nucleoside-nucleotide analogs. But we really haven't had any new drugs approved for 10 years. The most recent one, tenofovir alafenamide, is not exactly a new drug, but really a new formulation of tenofovir disoproxil fumarate, which we have had for 10 years. Currently available treatment isn't bad at all. With the oral antivirals, they have the ability to suppress the virus replication, reduce inflammation, as well as reverse fibrosis and even reverse cirrhosis. And with suppression of virus, there's prevention of progression to cirrhosis and liver failure, as well as a decreased risk of liver cancer. They're also extremely safe. However, they do not eradicate the cccDNA and certainly not the integrated HBV DNA. There's a very low rate of S antigen loss, even with continued treatment for several years. And therefore, many of these patients require long duration of treatment. And while the risk of HCC is reduced, it's not completely eliminated. And so one of the questions that have been frequently asked is whether hepatitis B cure is at all possible. Well, we know that this is going to be a difficult task because even in a natural setting, eradication of virus doesn't occur in patients with a very transient acute infection with rapid S antigen to S antibody seroconversion. We know that because the virus is still present in the liver, and upon immunosuppression, the virus can be reactivated. We also know that if we take the livers from these patients and transplant them to recipients who do not have immunity to hepatitis B, and these transplant recipients receive immunosuppressive therapy, we can cause transmission of infection. And the patients who have recovered from hepatitis B, the reason why they maintain very high titers of surface antibody for many, many decades is probably because there's residual low-level virus that constantly stimulate the immune response. So why is it so difficult to get rid of hepatitis B? We need to understand the hepatitis B virus life cycle. The virus enters into the hepatocytes through the entry receptor, which has now been identified to be the NTCP, sodium taurocholate co-transporting polypeptide. And upon entry, the envelope is shed, and the relaxed circular DNA is transported into the nucleus, where it is being repaired as the covalently closed circular DNA. It is bound to chromatin, and that can be modified so it can be transcriptionally active as well as transcriptionally silent. And the cccDNA is then transcribed into the viral DNA. We know that the pregenomic RNA is the one that is being reverse transcribed back to the HBV DNA, whereas the sub-RNAs are being translated into the viral protein. And the pregenomic RNA is being encapsulated into the core particle, where it's being reverse transcribed into the HBV DNA, and subsequently the relaxed circular DNA. This is being packaged, coated, and being secreted. But this core particle can also be recycled back into the hepatocyte nucleus. So this is the problem. You do not need to have entry of new virus, but just once the hepatocyte is infected, the virus can keep recirculating within the liver cells renew that cycle of infection. The cccDNA has a long half-life, and the current oral antivirals, because they only work on these steps, have no impact on direct effect of the cccDNA, and chronic hepatitis B patients also have impaired immune response. So these are the reasons why eradication of the virus is so difficult. Well, how can we actually eradicate cccDNA? There are several potential pathways. The first thing is we'll stop or decrease its production. So if we can block infection through entry inhibitors, that might help. If we can block conversion of the relaxed circular DNA, so once the virus enters, if we can prevent those virus to be converted into cccc DNA, that may help. If we can also block re-entry of the cccc DNA from the newly formed capsids, the recycling within the liver cells that I talk about, or if we can actually increase the turnover of infected cells. And nowadays, there's a lot of gene editing mechanism. The CRISPR mechanism, as well as even interferon, has some effect on increasing the degradation of cccc DNA. I've also mentioned that cccc DNA is bound to chromatin, and we can have epigenetic modifications that can increase or decrease its transcriptional activity. So for a long time, we don't understand the function of HBX protein, but we now know that it may have an impact on the transcriptional activity of cccc DNA, and there are companies that are working on HBX inhibitors, which might also have an impact. So let's talk about how we can get rid of cccc DNA. It's hidden inside the liver cells, and there are two potential mechanisms. One is through the non-cytolytic mechanism that Frank Cesari talked about, through cytokines, you don't need to kill the liver cells, but you actually get rid of the cccc DNA and the cell is still intact. We don't know what proportion of time this occurs, but the other way is to just get rid of the infected liver cells. So if there are three cells here, and you get rid of this infected cell, and you replenish this dead liver cell with an uninfected cell, so over time you have less infected cells. Or if it is replaced by this particular cell, which then divides, then you dilute the amount of cccc DNA. We don't really know in vivo which is the most important mechanism or the most dominant mechanism. Well, one thing is, when we talk about the goal is to get rid of cccc DNA, well, how do we know if we're there? How do we even measure it? So a direct measurement would require liver biopsy, which is going to be tricky. There's no standardized method. Every lab has its own method, and we don't know whether lab A has the same accuracy as lab B. And we need to be very careful because when you amplify the cccc DNA, there are a lot more relaxed circular DNA than cccc DNA, and we need to be able to differentiate between the two and be sure that the method is specific for cccc DNA and that we're not really measuring relaxed circular DNA. Now, we don't know if a small liver biopsy would give us a representative sample or whether it can be generalized. So everyone is looking for surrogate serum markers, but there's no standardization. The surrogate markers include quantitative S antigen, hepatitis B core-related antigen, but the most reliable one is probably if we can measure HBV RNA, pregenomic RNA. Let me show you a few examples. For almost a decade, everyone says that, well, quantitative S antigen may be a more reliable measure of cccc DNA than HBV DNA. It is certainly true, but this is really mostly true for E antigen positive patients in red, but for E antigen negative patients, the correlation is really not great. So when we talk about hepatitis B cure, well, what do we really want? Some of the experts are very idealistic, and they said, well, we want a sterilizing cure. Completely get rid of the virus, as if the patient had never been exposed to the virus, so they would be surface antigen negative, surface antibody, obviously negative, because you have never been exposed, no detectable virus in the blood as well as in the liver, and no integrated DNA as well. I think that it would probably take 1,000 years for us to get there, okay? So we then say, well, what about a functional cure? This is not complete eradication, but even then, experts differ. Idealistic functional cure would be like recovery after acute hepatitis B, surface antigen negative, surface antibody positive, E antigen negative, no detectable virus in the blood, but the virus is still detectable in the DNA, possibly not transcriptionally active, and it may be that there's already some integrated HBV DNA. Now, these patients would have minimal or no liver damage, and the risk of liver cancer is not increased. I'm not sure we can get there, because We get patients who've been chronically infected for 10, 20, 30 years before they come to our clinic. So I think that the realistic functional cure is more like someone with chronic hepatitis B, but with spontaneous S antigen loss and seroconversion to antibody, E antigen negative, undetectable virus in the DNA, still cccc DNA in the liver, but not transcriptionally active, and they certainly have integrated HBV DNA. So over time, these patients, they do have inactive liver disease, fibrosis regresses, liver cancer risk is decreased, but not completely zero. And that's what I think we hope we'll be able to get there in the next few years. Well, how do we get there? We have a much better understanding of the hepatitis B virus life cycle nowadays, and so we can design drugs that attack different parts of the virus life cycle. So in dark blue are pathways for which we already have drugs in clinical trials. Entry inhibitors block the virus from entering. RNA interference that block the viral DNA transcription and translation of viral proteins. Interference have multiple actions. We now have several companies with nucleic capsid assembly modificators, and we certainly have the polymerase inhibitors as well. There are also drugs that inhibit assembly of the virus. But potentially in the next few years, we'll also be hearing about inhibitors of conversion from relaxed circular DNA to cccc DNA, targeting the HBx and thereby modifying the cccc DNA transcription, as well as drugs that increase the degradation of cccc DNA. And we know that CRISPR, as well as gene editing approaches, are already in preclinical studies. So one example of entry inhibitors, which is Mercudex B, this blocks entry of the virus. This is a study in hepatitis B patients where they tested different dose levels. You can see that there's really not much decrease in HBV DNA and not much decrease in surface antigen as well. At the higher doses, there is a drop in HBV DNA, but unfortunately, there's no decline in surface antigen. This is actually being actively pursued for Delta infection right now. Well, another interesting approach is RNA interference. And what it happens is that these RNA interference inhibitors block the transcription of the pregenomic RNA as well as the viral proteins. So they decrease replication of the virus as well as decrease surface antigen production. And we hope that that would also help restore immune response. So how do they work? This is one example of siRNA approaches. In this particular instance, they gave the patients both the siRNA as well as entecavir. So not surprisingly, the DNA will be suppressed, so we're more interested in looking at decrease in surface antigen. And it is interesting that within a very short period of time, in the E antigen positive patients, there was about one log, and in some instances, a little bit further decrease in S antigen titer within just a matter of weeks. However, they saw a much less decline in surface antigen titer in the E antigen negative patients. And they were very surprised. They didn't understand what was going on. They repeated studies in chimpanzees and saw exactly the same effect. So then they studied the chimpanzees and analyzed the RNA transcripts. And lo and behold, which surprised us, is that when they compared the E antigen positive chimpanzee with the E antigen negative chimpanzee, the S transcripts in the E antigen negative chimpanzees were very defective. That the siRNA really targeted this particular region, and many of the RNA transcripts were missing in the E antigen negative chimpanzee. So that led them to conclude that the integrated HBV DNA, but not the cccc DNA, appears to be the predominant source of S antigen in E antigen negative chimps. So in a subsequent experiment, they designed new siRNAs, which target not just one particular region of the HBV transcripts, but multiple areas. And with that, they were able to see that if you use the previous approach, which is target this particular region, it didn't really drop the S antigen that much. But when they have targets against multiple regions, they're beginning to see a surface antigen decline. So one major thing is that for years we know that there's integrated HBV DNA, but we weren't paying attention other than it may cause liver cancer. But now We're wondering whether it is really a major source of S-antigen production, and if that's the case, we need to figure out how we can target integrated HBV DNA. So another group of compounds are the capsid assembly modulators. So what it does is it prevents, there are two classes of capsid assembly modifications. One of them results in dysfunctional or empty capsids, and they actually prevent packaging of the pregenomic RNA, or they actually don't package any pregenomic RNA, and therefore the virus cannot replicate, and viral protein would also be decreased. So the clinical studies, this is one example. Again, there are five or six such compounds in clinical trials. So this one, what they did was, after 4 weeks, they were able to see up to 2 to 3 log decline in HBV DNA, and they were also able to see a decline in HBV RNA as well, suggesting that maybe there's decrease in transcription of cccc DNA. These are very early phase clinical trials, so we need to know that a little bit more. Well, another group of compounds are the nucleic capsid polymers. These are really compounds that have been around in clinical trials for 10 years. We still don't completely understand how they work. They are believed to block S antigen, the small S antigen secretion. And they don't really have a direct impact in blocking virus production and the S antigen production. They just sort of block it from secreting. So one concern that I have is that, well, would you then have retention of these abnormal proteins in the liver cells and therefore cause liver injury? And that's still something that we don't completely understand. But this has been in clinical trials. The design of the clinical trial is actually complicated. And what they did was, in one group in blue, they started the patients with tenofovir first, and then they add PAC interferon, and finally they add the nucleic acid polymer. In the orange group, they also started patients on tenofovir first, but then they add the PAC as well as the nucleic acid polymer at the same time. So not surprisingly, you see the DNA decrease, but that may be just the effect of tenofovir. However, when you look at S antigen, what you see is that in orange, where they start the NAP earlier, you see this S antigen decline, and it's actually a 3-4 log decline. This is pretty impressive. Whereas in blue, with the PAC interferon, there's really not much, and only when you add the NAP, do you then start seeing it decrease. But one problem is that they saw quite severe hepatitis flares. ALT going up to 800, 1,000. None of the patients had bilirubin increase, but that's certainly a potential for safety concern that needs to be further explored. So finally, I've shared with you a few antiviral approaches. We all know that one of the problems is patients with chronic hepatitis B have impaired immune response. Is there any way by which we can restore immune response? So we learned from the natural experiment that in patients who are untreated, if you test the T-cell response against a variety of hepatitis B epitopes, you see almost nothing. However, in patients who have been treated with interferon and who had E antigen as well as S antigen loss, you see a gradual recovery of immune response. But this is really slow. 5 years after E and S antigen loss, not much recovery. It's only after 7, 8, or 10 years that you see the recovery. Similarly, there were studies also in patients who received NUTs. These are untreated patients, very minimally response. And in patients with spontaneously resolved chronic hepatitis B, you see some response. And patients who were so lucky to clear S antigen with the oral antiviral therapy, after a few years, they actually had some quite vigorous response. Now, this is encouraging because if it is possible to restore the immune response, then maybe if we can manipulate it, we'll be able to accelerate that process. So far, all immune therapies have failed. So I have a little bit of skepticism, but hopefully we'll be able to get there. So what other approaches that we can consider? Therapeutic vaccinations, stimulate T cells, B cells, or we block immunosuppressive pathways. We know that in our body, there are immune pathways that activate the response, and then there are pathways that dampen it down so that they don't go crazy. And lately in oncology, we hear a lot about the checkpoint inhibitors, and they're doing wonderful things to cancer patients, and perhaps we can apply those approaches. We'll focus more on cell-mediated immune response, but perhaps innate immunity is just as important, and there are certainly therapies targeted at TLR agonists. And finally, the most exciting thing in the oncology world these days is the CAR-T therapy. These are engineered T cells specifically targeting tumor antigens, and perhaps this approach of adaptive immunity, engineering T cells, might also be one way of treating hepatitis B. So in summary, I think that there is hope. I don't think that we'll have new treatment approved within the next 2 years. But 4 or 5 years from now, I hope that there will be. We'll need combination approaches, first by blocking virus replication, either using novel viral targets as well as nukes. And then we need to reduce viral antigen production, particularly S antigen. Perhaps using the siRNA approach or approaches targeting cccc DNA, and finally approaches to restore immune response. And I do hope that the pharmaceutical companies would be able to partner together and work together, because otherwise we'll have different companies all developing their own products and won't talk to each other. So the future is bright, and I hope that in a few years from now we'll not be just talk about dreams but reality. Thank you. So we now have the second speaker, and I'm very happy to call upon Professor Gadano from Argentina, and he's going to talk about monotherapy and suspension of treatment in news.
Buenos días a todos, dear Ana, querido Marcelo. Entonces, voy a tratar de responder o poner algo de luz a esta pregunta. Muy difícil también, tal vez no es una pregunta de $1,000,000, pero no debe estar lejos, que es, en nuestros pacientes tratados con nucleócidos o nucleótidos, ¿cuándo podemos, si es que podemos, interrumpir el tratamiento y de qué manera lo debiéramos hacer? Y si no podemos, ¿por qué motivos no podemos interrumpir el tratamiento? Estos son mis disclosures. Entonces, desde hace ya muchos años, y en esto casualmente hemos compartido estudios con Ana y Marcelo, tanto en pacientes tratados con entecavir como tenofovir, en pacientes antígeno E positivos, antígeno E negativos, está demostrado que al cabo del tiempo uno logra una muy alta supresión viral, y estas drogas y hoy también TAF nos han ayudado muchísimo en el tratamiento de estos pacientes. Fíjense ustedes como a 5 años o más allá de los 5 años, en la enorme mayoría de los pacientes tenemos más de 90-95% de pacientes con inhibición efectiva de la replicación viral. Ahora, entonces, si estas drogas son tan eficaces y tan seguras, ¿por qué interrumpir los nucleócidos? ¿Por qué interrumpir entecavir o tenofovir? Y esta es uno de los temas más controvertidos en el manejo de la hepatitis B crónica actualmente. Voy a revisar entonces qué es lo que dicen las guías actuales, contemplando esta pregunta, y cuáles son las evidencias en contra de la interrupción del tratamiento en 3 grupos especiales: pacientes con hepatitis crónica, antígeno E positivos o antígeno E negativos no cirróticos, y pacientes cirróticos, ya sean E positivos o E negativos. Veamos primero qué dicen las guías que han sido revisadas en el último año y medio, en relación a la interrupción de NUCs en pacientes E positivos. La guía europea dice que tenemos que tener una seroconversión del antígeno E y DNA indetectable, y luego de eso continuar con al menos 1 año de terapia de consolidación, o sea, continuar 1 año más e interrumpir. o pérdida o cero conversión del antígeno de superficie, que vemos, este es un punto muy difícil de lograr, de alcanzar. La guía americana dice lo mismo, la guía de Asian Pacific dice cero conversión del antígeno E, transaminasas normales y carga viral no detectable al menos 1 a 3 años con tratamiento de consolidación. De modo que estas son las recomendaciones para antígeno E no cirróticos. Ahora, si nosotros seguimos estas recomendaciones, y esta es una revisión sistemática reciente de George Papa, por no decir todo el apellido, que muestra, estas barras muestran luego de la interrupción del tratamiento. George mostró en esta revisión que al cabo de 36 meses, hasta 36 meses, en pacientes antígeno E positivos, si interrumpimos el tratamiento, ya sea cualquiera de los NUCs, vamos a tener, y estos son 733 pacientes en total, un 52% de pacientes que persisten con supresión virológica. Visto del otro lado, tenemos un 50% de pacientes con recaída virológica luego de 3 años de interrumpir los tratamientos. La tasa de recaída, entonces, en estos pacientes es alrededor de 50%, y si uno ve criterios intratratamiento en esos estudios que nos permitan decir este paciente va a recaer o este paciente no va a recaer, cuál entra en el 50% y cuál no, no tenemos ninguna evidencia intratratamiento hoy para decir puedo suspender el tratamiento con una buena garantía de que el paciente no va a recaer. El segundo punto, probablemente el más importante y muy importante para los países de nuestra región, es que el monitoreo después de interrumpir el tratamiento no está garantizado. Acá tenemos dos problemas. Tenemos países de muy alta prevalencia y muy alta prevalencia en países de muy bajos recursos o áreas dentro de Latinoamérica de muy bajos recursos. Entonces, tenemos una disponibilidad limitada de pruebas. Y para nosotros decidir la interrupción del tratamiento, necesitamos dos cosas sí o sí. Primero, saber que el paciente no es cirrótico. Entonces, tenemos que acceder a un método que nos permita saber, por lo menos un fibroscan o biopsia o algo que nos permita saber que el paciente no está cirrótico. Tenemos un límite para acceder a estos métodos. Segundo, necesitamos disponer de HBV-DNA para seguir al paciente luego de la interrupción del tratamiento y estar seguros de que el paciente no recae. Segundo límite importante en nuestros países. Así que esta es otra limitante para al momento de decidir la interrupción del tratamiento. Tercero y cuarto, posibilidad de reactivación severa en caso de inmunosupresión. El paciente puede estar en remisión, pero si es sometido a inmunosupresión, va a haber otra charla de esto, el paciente puede reactivar de manera severa y posibilidad de transmisión a otros pacientes en caso de recaída. ¿Qué podemos decir ahora de los pacientes antígeno E negativos? Las guías dicen, la guía europea, después de al menos 3 años de supresión virológica en pacientes en quienes el monitoreo puede ser realizado de manera cercana, o pérdida o cero conversión del antígeno de superficie. La guía americana dice solamente pérdida o cero conversión del antígeno de superficie y la guía asiática dice luego de 2 años de DNA indetectable o cero conversión del antígeno de superficie. ¿Qué pasa, digamos, cuando suspendemos el tratamiento en pacientes no cirróticos antígeno E negativos? La misma revisión de George Papateodoritis mostró que en este caso, fíjense, cerca de 1,000 pacientes, es mayor aún la tasa de recaída. El 30% de pacientes son los pacientes que persisten a 3 años con supresión virológica. Quiere decir que el 70% de los pacientes recae tras la interrupción del tratamiento. Entonces, en este caso, 70% de recaída, lo mismo que dije para antígeno E positivo. El monitoreo no está garantizado en muchas áreas, posibilidad de reactivación y posibilidad de transmisión viral. En los últimos años hemos intentado establecer, lo mismo que en E positivos, pero más aún en E negativos, un nivel de cutoff de la cuantificación del antígeno de superficie para poder decir, este paciente que tiene un antígeno de superficie por debajo de un determinado cutoff tiene buenas chances de mantener la supresión virológica si interrumpo el tratamiento. Entonces, la determinación cuantitativa del HBsAg podría ser una herramienta para decidir la interrupción del tratamiento. Y eso, fíjense, que tiene bastante sensibilidad y especificidad, pero aún hoy esto no puede ser aplicado en la práctica clínica. No sabemos qué tan bajo debe ser el nivel alcanzado de este antígeno, durante cuánto tiempo debemos tener esta cuantificación baja, y la prueba realmente no está disponible, más aún en nuestros países, entonces todavía no nos ayuda a tomar decisiones de interrupción de tratamiento. Ahora, en los pacientes con cirrosis, ya sean E positivos o E negativos, las recomendaciones de las guías son bastante uniformes. La guía europea no lo recomienda, la guía americana no recomienda la interrupción y la guía de Asian Pacific considera que puede ser considerada en cirrosis compensada con un monitoreo muy cercano de estos pacientes. Esto, la opinión nuestra personal, la opinión también vertida en la última edición de la guía latinoamericana, indica que no es recomendable y que los pacientes con cirrosis deben continuar el tratamiento de por vida. ¿Por qué? Porque la interrupción del tratamiento en pacientes con cirrosis es conocido que puede determinar recaídas con descompensación de la cirrosis. Fíjense, en el estudio asiático, 16% de flares severas y en ambos estudios entre 0.5 y 1% de mortalidad tras la interrupción de nucleócidos en esta población de pacientes. Del otro lado, ¿cuáles serían las desventajas para un tratamiento a largo plazo? ¿Qué problema hay si nosotros continuamos en forma indefinida el tratamiento con NUX? Hay problemas de resistencia, tal vez, que entran al momento de decisión, problemas de toxicidad, planificación del embarazo, costos y adherencia de los pacientes. Veamos uno por uno si realmente son barreras. El tema de la resistencia es extremadamente baja hoy, a largo plazo, tanto con entecavir como con tenofovir, y se anticipa ser igual con TAF. De modo que no tenemos un problema real e incluso si tenemos resistencia podemos resolver este problema haciendo un switch a la otra familia de nucleócidos o nucleótidos. El tema de la toxicidad se plantea fundamentalmente para los análogos nucleótidos, sobre todo para tenofovir. En tenofovir la posibilidad a largo plazo de complicaciones renales o de complicaciones óseas. Esto hoy ya no es un problema, tenemos la posibilidad de usar, que está aprobado para hepatitis B, TAF, y ahí está bien claro en estas indicaciones, en las últimas guías, cuáles son los pacientes que debieran hacer un switch a TAF o en quienes se debiera iniciar TAF de nuevo, pacientes de edad avanzada, con enfermedad ósea, con enfermedad o posibilidad de desarrollar enfermedad renal. Uno puede priorizar TAF sobre tenofovir o hacer un switch de tenofovir a entecavir y este problema no es un problema. El tema de la planificación del embarazo tampoco debiera ser un problema porque tenemos drogas de categoría B como tenofovir o TAF que pueden ser utilizadas con seguridad durante el embarazo. Cuarto punto, el tema de los costos, un problema importante y real, sobre todo en nuestros países. La Organización Mundial de la Salud hace, si bien es un problema, hace cada vez más accesibles estos medicamentos. Hoy, los países miembros y en el último reporte de la Organización Mundial de la Salud indica que el tratamiento está disponible en la gran mayoría de estos países por un costo menor a $50 al año. De modo que es muy importante en cada uno de nuestros países poder lograr este objetivo, esta recomendación de la Organización Mundial de la Salud. Por otro lado, si suspendiéramos el tratamiento, tenemos que estimar también el costo de una potencial recaída y el costo del monitoreo después del tratamiento, que puede ser entre estos dos más costoso que la continuación del tratamiento. Finalmente, ¿Cuál es la adherencia, el problema de adherencia de un paciente que tiene que continuar durante años y años con una medicación, un comprimido al día? Y solo traigo un trabajo, hay varios trabajos que muestran que esto no es un problema, pero traje un trabajo del grupo de Ana, donde muestra, fíjense en la última columna, las últimas tres columnas, muestra todos los pacientes en la columna celeste, pero en la columna que está más hacia la izquierda, se muestra que los nuevos pacientes tienen tasas más bajas de adherencia a NUX. Entonces, lo que podríamos decir es que si nosotros interrumpimos y tenemos que recomenzar un tratamiento, interrumpimos y recomenzamos, estos pacientes en donde la medicación se vuelve a introducir tendría una adherencia más baja que en pacientes que continúan el tratamiento sin interrumpir. De modo que, a modo de conclusión, podemos decir que en pacientes con hepatitis crónica antígeno E positivo, los nucleósidos pueden ser interrumpidos después de al menos un año de seroconversión del antígeno E, solo si se puede realizar un monitoreo cercano. Y esto es, repito, muy importante en nuestros países al momento de tomar la decisión. En pacientes antígeno E negativos, la tasa de recaída virológica es muy alta y, por lo tanto, interrumpir los NUCs no sería una buena opción hasta tanto haya mejores predictores de remisión virológica sostenida y que puedan aplicarse a la práctica clínica. En pacientes con hepatitis B crónica, con cirrosis, tanto antígeno E positivos como negativos, la interrupción de los NUCs puede estar asociada con descompensación e incluso muerte, por lo tanto, el tratamiento en estos pacientes debe continuarse de por vida hasta tanto tengamos nuevos tratamientos que nos permitan, de acuerdo a la charla anterior, reducir o eliminar el cccDNA, que es el gran responsable de esto que yo acabo de comentar. De nuevo que la familia de los NUCs en este honorable auditorio y en este Hard Rock Hotel le suplica, al menos en esas poblaciones, don't stop me now, ¿ok? Muchas gracias.
Gracias, Adrián. Muy buena conferencia. Ahora le pedimos, por favor, al doctor David Bernstein que suba. Su charla va a ser reactivación del virus de la hepatitis B. David es vicepresidente de Medicina para Ensayos Clínicos, jefe de hepatología y director del Sandra Atlas Bass Center para Enfermedades Hepáticas, Northwell Health, y profesor de medicina y educación en la Escuela de Medicina de Zucker y Escuela de Medicina de Hofstra, Northwell. David, thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Locke, Marcelo. I can't tell you what a pleasure it is to be here. I'd first like to congratulate and thank Fernando for inviting me. We've been friends for more than 20 years. And have done a lot together, and also to really thank Marcelo, who was one of my professors when I was training at the University of Miami, and it's so nice to see so many of my colleagues who were all fellows together from all the different Latin American countries here. So again, thank you. My task is to talk a little bit today about hepatitis B reactivation. And I think it's becoming a very, very important discussion that we're having with our patients, but also with physicians who care for patients, whether they have an oncologic problem, whether they have a rheumatologic problem, and in particular amongst our fellow gastroenterologists all in the room. So to sort of set the stage, how do we define hepatitis B reactivation? And we can use different wording, but perhaps the easiest thing to do, it's truly the loss of hepatitis B immune control in a patient that has inactive or resolved hepatitis B infection. And I think the resolved portion is also important as we talk in a bit. It's characterized by the reappearance or an increase in viral replication occurring during or following immune reconstitution. And we typically see significant rises, which I'll go over, in HBV DNA followed by transaminase elevations. So I think we need to all understand the quote definition. And it's important. Because as I said earlier, as we are seeing more and more patients getting immunosuppression, TNF medications, anti-TNF, the incidence of hepatitis B reactivation is on the rise. And it is preventable with education. And I think that's really the key point. If we were to educate the physicians to look for hepatitis B in the patient populations that they are going to place on immunosuppressive type agents, we can prevent hepatitis B reactivation from occurring. So education is critical. Not going to discuss much about that here, but again, I think that's our job to all go back to our communities to educate. The clinical range of hepatitis B reactivation is really across the gamut, and it can be from subclinical to severe hepatitis to liver failure and death. And if we think of the patient populations that may be affected, those are folks that many cases have an underlying malignancy. So if they then develop fulminant failure from hepatitis B, they're not candidates for transplantation. And so again, the importance of looking for hepatitis B before starting patients on these therapies is important. Why? Well, we've heard a lot about the cccDNA from the previous two speakers. I'm simple. So in a pictorial, you know, fashion, someone had hepatitis B or has inactive hepatitis B, they have this cccDNA in the hepatocyte nucleus. And they're either under good control or it's not being expressed, or if it's being expressed, it's going to be subclinical, right? We have an immune system which keeps it at bay if small amounts of virus are actually released, and there are studies in patients that have had hepatitis B and cleared where biopsies have been done, and you can stain the biopsy for HBV DNA and it can turn positive. So the virus still exists. If that immunosuppression, if that immune response is blunted from whatever, then it gives the virus an opportunity to proliferate, and we can then develop reactivation. And so you can see here a patient looked over time who had hepatitis B, now has undetectable virus with a normal ALT, under good immune control. Immunosuppression is initiated. First thing that you're going to see is an elevation in HBV DNA. And then with immune reconstitution, E antigen will become positive if negative, and the patient will develop elevated transaminases. And here's where the problem is. So the importance, again, is to try to find this beforehand. Dr. Locke had, I think, the seminal paper on this back in 1991, where she described 100 patients who with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma who were given chemotherapy. And you can see here half of the patients develop some sort of hepatitis B reactivation, ranging from the subclinical to fatality. And unfortunately, it took another 20 years before the worldwide community recognized the importance of this work and recognized that this problem does exist. Here you can see just an example again from something done about 15 years ago, how immunosuppression and in addition of prednisolone to that and high-dose steroids can also increase the risk of developing hepatitis B reactivation. So we know the problem exists. It all comes back again to finding the patients beforehand and then being able to hopefully, you know, initiate. We can divide hepatitis B reactivation patient groups into two. Those that are hepatitis B surface antigen positive with or without HBV DNA, and those who are hepatitis B surface antigen negative but have an isolated detectable hepatitis B core antibody. And since it's really quite common to see folks that have all markers negative other than a positive hepatitis B core antibody, that's a group that we need to actually look for. When does hepatitis B reactivation occur? Well, it can occur within 2 weeks of initiation of immunosuppression, but perhaps more frightful, it can occur a year out after stopping immunosuppression, which is why, again, it's so important to follow these patients. And that's a pretty distinct timeline. I think the last thing that we would want to do is treat someone, cure their cancer, or keep their Crohn's disease under good control, and then have them flare for hepatitis B that, again, could have been recognized and prevented. Risk factors for hepatitis B reactivation can be placed into three large categories: host factors, virologic factors, and then the type and degree of immunosuppression that is being given. What are some host factors that increase the risk of hepatitis B reactivation? It's more common in men. It's more common in people who are immunologically older. It's more common in those that have underlying cirrhosis. And it's more common in those that have lymphoma or leukemia. And again, the liquid tumors and lymphoma are where this was truly first described as a problem. Virologic factors, you're more likely to see reactivation in someone that has detectable virus. And so again, that's important. You're more likely to see it in someone who's E antigen positive. You're more likely to see it in someone who doesn't have the hepatitis A, doesn't have the genotype A for hepatitis B. And I'll come to at the end, you're more likely to see hepatitis B reactivation in someone who was successfully treated with current DAAs for hepatitis C. So that's a whole nother area of hepatitis B reactivation, the patient who's cured of their hepatitis C. We define or divide risk of reactivation into three different groups: high risk, which would be a greater than 10% of reactivation, moderate between 1 and 10, and low risk, which would be less than 1%. Right? And that's very important. Why? You've seen a similar slide earlier presented by Dr. Locke, but the body has a very complex way of controlling the immune response elicited by the hepatitis B virus. If we were to interfere with that, then we allow potentially the hepatitis B virus to proliferate, reactivate, and cause its problems. And so the life cycle becomes important, but equally important is understanding where along the way we are interfering with the immune response and how, which ones are more important than others, so to speak, to go forward. When we think about immunomodulatory therapies, there are a whole host of them. I'll come back to, but would like to mention now, perhaps the most critical to know about is rituximab, right, which has an extraordinarily high risk of reactivation. To the gastroenterologists in the audience, of which I think there are many, anti-TNFs place patients at risk for reactivation. So if you're practicing gastroenterology in an area where there's a high prevalence of hepatitis B, you really should look. And then there are other medications that we use. Rituximab is a particular problem and perhaps the best described. It's a monoclonal antibody against the CD20, which reduces the number of B cells and suppresses the immune response. It's commonly used now in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, in CLL, but also in rheumatoid arthritis. So our rheumatology colleagues need to be aware of this. There is a significantly increased risk of reactivation with rituximab in those patients that are isolated hepatitis B core antibody alone. And that led to the FDA in the US issuing a black box warning regarding the importance of following these patients and looking for hepatitis B and reminding us that reactivation can occur up to a year after the last dose of the medication. Right. Dr. Raj Reddy, who's another person who trained me at the University of Miami, published his paper back in 2015, which really looked at what groups are high risk, moderate risk, and low risk. So if we look to what would be your left and look at those patients that are surface antigen positive and core antibody positive, or surface antigen negative and core antibody positive, so isolated core, those patients getting B-cell depleting agents, of which rituximab is the most common, need to be started and then need to be continued for a year afterwards. In those patients that are surface antigen positive and core antibody positive, or just surface antigen positive, who are getting an erythrocycline derivative or who are getting higher doses of prednisone, at least 10 milligrams for more than 4 weeks, need to be started and need to be continued for 6 months after cessation of immunotherapy. Moderate risk groups are TNF, patients getting TNF inhibitors, patients who are getting tyrosine kinase inhibitors, or cytokine or integrin inhibitors. And these patients also, from this paper, are recommended, if they're core antibody positive alone, to be placed on therapy and to have that continued for at least 6 months. after cessation. Other moderate groups would be those getting who are surface antigen positive, who are getting lower dose of prednisone, but for more than 4 weeks. And for those that are isolated core antibody positive, who are getting prednisone more than 10 milligrams for greater than 4 weeks, who are getting an anthracycline derivative, and these patients also should be treated for 6 months after cessation of the immunosuppressive therapy. Low-risk groups, those getting azathioprine, those getting 6-MP, those getting intra-articular steroids, those who are surface antigen negative but isolated core antibody positive, getting low doses of prednisone, do not need any type of antiviral prophylaxis, can then be followed. And so I would refer you to this paper because it really puts it out there very nicely and it's very easy to read. So how can then we prevent hepatitis B reactivation? Well, we need to look for it. And we need to check for surface antigen and core antibody as our first line tests in all individuals undergoing immunosuppression. In those patients that are surface antigen positive, you should be checking for HBV DNA. You really don't need to look for hepatitis B surface antibody because it doesn't change what you're going to do for your patient that may not necessarily be protective as one goes forward. This looks at lamivudine and looking at two different approaches. Preemptive, meaning let's start the patient before they get immunosuppression, versus let's give it on demand once they've shown that they're developing a reactivation. And you can see here survival is better if you start earlier, before the patient is given immunosuppressive therapy, than waiting for a problem to occur. And I think most people would agree that it's better to start before the patient begins chemotherapy. This looks at tenofovir in patients that were starting rituximab, and you can see the group that got tenofovir versus the group that was just observed. Yes, the numbers are small, but there were no reactivations and no recurrent and no fatalities in the patients that received tenofovir. 16% of the folks who were just observed developed a reactivation. Again, a strong meaning or a strong study to tell us that we should start therapy sooner before we start treatment. What are your options? It's really whatever is available to you, and you've heard about this, whatever is cheapest will work. Entecavir, TDF, or TAF are all reasonable to use. And again, it's going to be dependent on what you can get. Ideally, this should be started before you initiate chemotherapy or immunosuppression, 1 to 2 weeks. But if you can start it at the same time, that's also good. You shouldn't hold chemotherapy or immunosuppressive therapy in someone who needs it while you're waiting for this, as long as you're assured that the patient can actually get it. And when you stop the hepatitis B studies, hepatitis B medications, you should also then monitor for hepatitis B reactivation after stopping. The AASLD recently changed and updated its guidance and recommends that all patients who are receiving immunosuppression, cytotoxic therapy, or any type of immunomodulatory therapy be screened for the risk for hepatitis B, surface antigen, and core antibody. And this goes along with the recommendations of the CDC in the US, EASL, and ASCO to look. And this has been a monumental shift from Dr. Locke's first description in 1991 to today. It took 20 to 25 years, and hopefully this will catch on. Still in the United States, the majority of oncologists don't look for hepatitis B before starting, and studies are showing anywhere between 30 and 40% now look. Going to conclude with just a few slides on hepatitis B reactivation after successful hepatitis C treatment, because I think this is a growing area. There have been now several descriptions of patients that had hepatitis C co-infected with hepatitis B, whose hepatitis C was treated. We now learned earlier this morning that we're curing everybody. And there have then been reactivation of the hepatitis B when the hepatitis C no longer is holding it at bay. This led the FDA in the US to issue a black box warning for all DAA therapies for hepatitis C that you screen for hepatitis B prior to starting. There were 29 cases that were reported. Two were fatalities, one required a liver transplant, and one of the two actually was core antibody positive alone. And so this is something that you could look for. We haven't seen it in our practice, but again, our practice, I don't think is large enough that you would actually find, because the numbers are small and the mechanism for reactivation is unknown. These are the recommendations from the ASLD to screen again for surface antigen and core antibody before initiating hepatitis C therapy. Obviously, if the patient fits the criteria for hepatitis B therapy, they should be started on that. If not, they should be observed. Right? And you may want to check every 3 to 6 months and every 3 to 6 months afterwards for a period of 6 months. So this is available on the ASLD website. So in summary, all patients who are to be started on immunosuppressive therapy, chemotherapy, or DAA therapy for hepatitis C should be screened for hepatitis B. The initial screening tests are a surface antigen and a core antibody. Prophylactic therapy is indicated for those patients that are high risk with either tenofovir or entecavir. And I'll stress again that hepatitis B reactivation is a preventable complication if we look and if we educate our colleagues who are going to be using these immunosuppressive therapies that exists. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Dr. Bernstein. And we now move on to the next talk. So this will be on hepatitis delta, which is oftentimes a forgotten disease. But in some pockets in the world, this is fairly common. And we're very fortunate to have one of the world's experts, Professor Raimundo Perana from Brazil, who's done a lot of work in this area to talk about hepatitis delta.
Thank you, Ana. Muy buenos días. Les prometo que después de la gestión de Ale hablaré español, pero mientras que esto no aconteza, tengan paciencia con mi portuñol. Intentaré hablar despacio. Muy bien, ¿cómo se hace? Hablaremos sobre la hepatitis delta con el foco en hepatitis delta en América Latina, porque tenemos claramente una enfermedad diferente de la hepatitis delta que se ve en otros continentes. Los conflictos de interés. Entonces, la hepatitis delta aún es responsable por 15 millones de enfermos en todos los continentes. Y es una de las enfermedades más negligenciadas en todo el mundo, sobre todo en América Latina. Es un virus que depende del virus de la hepatitis B. Es el único virus que hace esto en la especie humana. Es una enfermedad relativamente bien controlada en Estados Unidos y Europa, pero no en Latinoamérica. La hepatitis delta se puede ser adquirida en conjunto con la hepatitis B, a esto llamamos de coinfección, que se asemeja muchísimo a hepatitis aguda B, con elevadas tasas de cura, de curación. Por otro lado, cuando la hepatitis delta infecta a un enfermo que ya tiene hepatitis B, llamamos superinfección, y hay elevadas tasas de cronicidad y una enfermedad que evoluye muy, muy rápidamente. Este mapa de hepatitis delta está presente en todos los continentes, pero en América Latina los países asiáticos sufren con esta enfermedad. En las poblaciones más aisladas y más pobres. Es por eso que es una enfermedad muy negligenciada, porque esta población no tiene voz política en nuestros países. Para el diagnóstico y monitoreo de la hepatitis delta necesitamos los estudios bioquímicos, sorológicos, virológicos. Tenemos que entender las cuestiones del huésped y también la histología desafortunadamente, en muchos de nuestros países, sobre todo en la región donde la hepatitis delta es endémica, no tenemos todas estas herramientas para monitorear los enfermos. La hepatitis delta es conocida como una enfermedad más grave, es la más grave entre las tres hepatitis y es la que llega más rápidamente al estadio de cirrosis hepática. En Amazonia, como ven, los enfermos son jóvenes y cuando tienen el diagnóstico de la hepatitis delta, la mayoría son ya cirróticos o precirróticos, unos 45% más o menos. Lo que nos dice que esta enfermedad está subdiagnosticada en nuestro continente y que los enfermos sufren a largo plazo con una enfermedad que no es diagnosticada. Y entre las variables que están claramente relacionadas con la evolución de la enfermedad hepática es la carga viral de la hepatitis delta, más que cualquier otra variable en nuestro medio. Esto es diferente de Europa y Estados Unidos. Y a ver si la epidemiología puede influenciar el cuadro clínico de nuestros pacientes. Sí, aparentemente sí, porque vea que en Europa, Estados Unidos, tenemos una enfermedad controlada que está restrita a algunos grupos de riesgo o a inmigrantes. Mientras que en nuestro continente, los casos son autóctonos, los enfermos son muy, muy jóvenes, muchas veces contraen la hepatitis delta entre 1 y 10 años, una transmisión intrafamiliar. La enfermedad parece muy severa, más severa que en otros países. Hay mutaciones adaptativas y hay genótipos específicos de hepatitis B que pueden también influenciar en los desfechos de nuestros pacientes. Y hay peculiaridades clínicas que yo voy a mostrar. La primera es esta, que es llamada en nuestro continente de varias denominaciones. En Brasil se llama fiebre de Labria, en Colombia fiebre de Santa Marta, fiebre de la Sierra Nevada, fiebre de los indios Yanoromi en Ecuador y fiebre de los indios Yuquipa en Venezuela. Todos ellos tienen en común una hepatitis muy, muy grave que tiene peculiaridades histológicas bien diferentes de la hepatitis, de la insuficiencia hepática fulminante por hepatitis viral que vemos en otros locales. Como ven, no hay mucha necrosis, pero las células hepáticas están balonizadas con el citoplasma lleno de grasa. Y el enfermo entra en fallo hepático muy rápidamente con una mortalidad que es próxima a 100%. Y como peculiaridad en esta enfermedad, observen que estas células balonizadas, que llamamos células de mórula o espongiócitos, concentran los antígenos de la hepatitis B y los antígenos de la hepatitis delta. Hay algo que direcciona la replicación viral para estas células. No sabemos exactamente lo que pasa, pero es una enfermedad mortal. En Brasil ha sido descrita, ahora está la incidencia es más baja, en toda la Amazonia occidental, como también en otros países que hacen frontera con Brasil. Están casi todos los casos relacionados al genótipo 1, pero en Venezuela, genótipo 3, pero en Venezuela la fiebre de la hepatitis de índios Yuquipa estaba relacionada al genotipo 1 del virus Delta y en Brasil genotipo 3. En Brasil tenemos también el genotipo 8 que ha sido descrito recientemente en las comunidades quilombolas, que son las comunidades de descendientes africanos que han permanecido aisladas en algunas áreas del nordeste del país. Como peculiaridad biomolecular, tenemos dos genótipos, el genótipo del virus de hepatitis B, que es lo más divergente de todos, genótipo F, y lo menos conocido también. Y el genótipo 3 del Delta es también lo más divergente. Por lo tanto, tenemos que generar conocimiento sobre la nuestra hepatitis Delta, porque no podemos importar los conocimientos que vienen de Europa y Estados Unidos. La interrelación entre la hepatitis Delta y la hepatitis B es variable y ha sido descrita de maneras diferentes. Hay casos donde la hepatitis B es suprimida por la hepatitis Delta, hay casos donde la hepatitis Delta, la replicación es muy, muy baja, pero en nuestro continente costumamos tener los dos virus replicando al mismo tiempo. Esto puede, en parte, explicar la evolución más grave de la enfermedad. Vean en nuestros primeros casos de transplantación de trasplante en Amazonia, que la edad de los enfermos es muy baja, 31 años, y el trasplante se hace muy rápido después del diagnóstico. Esto probablemente porque tenemos ese perfil: hepatitis B replicando, hepatitis Delta replicando, y unos 25% de nuestros enfermos son HBE positivo, lo que no se pasa en otros países. Es por eso que las guías brasileñas para el tratamiento de la hepatitis Delta nos permite hacer, mismo que empíricamente, la asociación entre nucleocídeos e interferón pegilado por lo menos un año. Hay otras peculiaridades. Vean la expresión del antígeno Delta en enfermos con enfermedad crónica, con hepatitis crónica Delta. La cantidad de antígeno Delta que está en el citoplasma de las células es enorme. No se ve esto en otros países. Al mismo tiempo, hay gran cantidad de hepatitis Delta, y a izquierda ve que hay también HBC, antígeno HBC, lo que dice que los dos virus están replicando. Si comparamos la expresión del antígeno Delta en países enfermos con genótipo 3 y genótipo 1, se ve que en enfermos con genótipo 3, la cantidad de la expresión del antígeno y la localización citoplasmática es más acentuada. Recientemente, una mutación muy, muy curiosa, muy, muy interesante ha sido descrita en nuestro país, en Brasil, y esta mutación es muy prevalente entre los enfermos que tienen genotipo 3 del virus Delta infectando genotipo no F del virus de hepatitis B, lo que nos hace pensar que se puede ser una mutación adaptativa. Todavía no tenemos, aún no tenemos respuesta para eso. ¿Qué tal la etnicidad? Estos son los enfermos de hepatitis Delta del ambulatorio de Rondônia. Se ve que son todos indígenas, gente simples que vive en las aldeas, son las víctimas de hepatitis Delta. Pero hay múltiples etnias. Y es difícil explicar. Esta es un estudio epidemiológico que ha sido hecho en un valle de Amazonia con diversas poblaciones vecinas. Y observe que en algunas tienen una prevalencia enorme y en otras no hay hepatitis Delta. Lo mismo se pasa en Pakistán y otros países de elevada prevalencia. Es difícil explicar por qué una población tan próxima, tan cerca una de la otra, una tiene una prevalencia enorme, la otra no tiene ningún caso de hepatitis delta. Muy, muy difícil explicar. Es por eso que ha sido planeado un consorcio internacional de lo cual hacemos parte aquí en América Latina, que tiene como nuestro capitán el profesor Michael Mans, y que ha publicado recientemente que la hepatitis delta, ha demostrado recientemente que la hepatitis delta no es una única enfermedad, pero una enfermedad que es diferente en cada país. Estos son pacientes de nuestro ambulatorio en Amazonia, donde se ve el vaso del paciente con hepatitis delta es completamente diferente de lo que se ve en enfermos. Esto no tiene relación con la hipertensión portal. Hay algo que se pasa en estos enfermos que probablemente estimula inmunológicamente y hace el vaso crecer que llega hasta la fosa ilíaca. Es algo muy, muy interesante y que se debe ser estudiado. Bueno, para tratamiento de hepatitis delta no tenemos mucha cosa. La respuesta sostenida al interferón está por abajo de 20%, no más. No tenemos estudios en América Latina con nuestros genótipos, pero sabemos que si no hay B, no hay delta. Entonces, estamos pensando que si los tratamientos para hepatitis B mejoran, avanzan, los enfermos con hepatitis delta serán obviamente beneficiados. Hay muchos estudios, Analoc ha ya presentado las nuevas propuestas, las nuevas drogas, y todas ellas podrán nos ayudar en el control y tratamiento de la hepatitis delta. Pero para la hepatitis delta específicamente, tenemos una droga que está en fase de estudio, que son los inhibidores de prenilación. Es una droga que promete, pero hay limitaciones causadas por los efectos adversos, sobre todo los efectos adversos gastrointestinales. Es un factor limitante. Por fin, agradezco a todos y digo que tenemos un proyecto de salud itinerante para cuidar de estos enfermos, y estos son nuestros colegas extranjeros que han nos ayudado a lo largo de 20 años para entrenamiento de personal y control de la hepatitis delta en Amazonia. Y muchas gracias.
Bueno, gracias Raimundo por tremenda presentación y experiencia. Ahora vamos a hacer un caso clínico. Invitamos al doctor Javier Díaz Ferrer de Perú. Javier es gastroenterólogo y hepatólogo del Hospital Edgardo Rebagliati Martins de Salud, Lima, Perú, en la Clínica Internacional Sede San Borja, y es profesor de medicina de la Universidad Nacional Mayor de San Marcos y Universidad de San Martín de Porres.
Buenos días. Para mí es un tremendo placer y un gran honor compartir la mesa con todos ustedes, grandes profesores y amigos. La hepatitis B sigue siendo un desafío para nosotros y un gran dolor de cabeza. Voy a compartir con ustedes un caso que hemos evaluado recientemente. Se trata de una mujer de 24 años de edad, diagnosticada de hepatitis B en el año 2015, con un diagnóstico de portador inactivo. Solo tenemos el dato del 2015 de ese DNA viral de 800 unidades internacionales por mililitro y unas transaminasas normales. No existe más dato, y desde el 2015 la paciente se pierde, no hay mayores controles, y acude a nuestro hospital, derivada de su centro de salud, en septiembre del 2017, ya con el diagnóstico de una gestación de 34 semanas y con un tiempo de enfermedad de 3 días caracterizado por dolor abdominal intenso a predominio del hipocondrio derecho. Se le hace una ecografía abdominal en la emergencia y lo que se le encuentra es una masa de aspecto tumoral de aproximadamente 8 centímetros de diámetro en el lóbulo hepático derecho. Se le pide la serología de hepatitis B, y lo que se encuentra es antígeno de superficie positivo, el antígeno E negativo, el anticuerpo IgG positivo y el resto de marcadores serológicos negativos, lo que en apariencia concordaba con el diagnóstico inicial de portador inactivo. Tiene una evaluación nutricional con una desnutrición calórico-proteica severa a pesar de la gestación. Y dentro de los exámenes de laboratorio que se piden al ingreso de esta paciente se encuentra otra vez una carga viral, un DNA viral en 430 unidades internacionales por mililitro, alfa-fetoproteína, como ven ustedes allí, en niveles muy altos, un CA19-9 en valores normales, las proteínas, la albúmina muy baja, 2.52, las bilirrubinas en 1.7, las transaminasas, la TGO en 249, la TGP en 47, la hemoglobina en 8.3, las plaquetas en 512.000, la glucosa en 36 miligramos por decilitro, la urea y la creatinina dentro de los valores normales. Dado esto, y dado que la paciente seguía con dolores, sometida a cesárea, y se obtiene un recién nacido de 2,5 kilos, con un Apgar aparentemente bueno, y se somete a este paciente, o se le administra inmunización con inmunoglobulina y vacunación rápida dentro de las primeras 12 horas, y se inicia a la paciente en Entecavir 0,5 miligramos por día. Estas son las imágenes de la resonancia postparto, donde pueden ustedes ver allí las imágenes tumorales. En una de las imágenes se puede ya ver un poco el útero involutivo, pero como pueden ver, una lesión tumoral muy grande en el contexto de una paciente recién sometida a cesárea. Adicionalmente nos informan en el reporte de esta resonancia que hay compromiso tumoral de la vena porta y de la vena mesentérica superior. Dicho esto, una cosa que a nosotros nos llama muchísimo la atención es que, y que nosotros solemos verlo ocasionalmente en pacientes nuestros, es que estas pacientes que teóricamente son diagnosticadas como portadoras inactivas y con una carga viral muy bajita y que las guías, la guía americana, la guía europea misma, como ustedes pueden ver allí, mencionan que ante transaminasas normales y una carga viral muy bajita, son pacientes que no deberían recibir tratamiento y deberían estar en monitoreo. Monitoreo, es verdad que esta paciente la perdimos de contacto y no la tuvimos cercana a nosotros más de un año sin evolución, pero en este lapso nos apareció, además de con una gestación, un tumor muy grande. Entonces, tanto la guía americana como la guía europea recomiendan en estos pacientes, de ser detectados, solo seguimiento. Y en el caso de ya estar gestando, solo tratamiento si la carga viral es mayor de 200.000 unidades internacionales por mililitro y a partir del tercer trimestre de la gestación, aunque bien podría darse, como dijo también el doctor Gadano, tenofovir, por ser una droga de categoría B en cualquier momento de la gestación. Esto plantea para nosotros un gran reto en el virus de hepatitis B. Quizás, como bien había dicho también el doctor Raimundo Paraná, a lo mejor hay una asociación con virus Delta que nosotros no lo estamos viendo y esto genera un riesgo incrementado de desarrollar hepatocarcinoma. Si la forma ideal de seguimiento en estos pacientes, entre comillas, portadores inactivos, es con el DNA viral, elastografía, las transaminasas o quizá también, como habían mencionado, la cuantificación del antígeno de superficie va a ser una herramienta que nos permita establecer qué pacientes tienen riesgo no solo de desarrollar una enfermedad avanzada por el virus B, sino una complicación asociada al virus B que es infrecuente, pero que para nosotros no lo es tanto. Alguna forma de evitar, como dije, no hay consenso también en relación al seguimiento o la forma de evitar el hepatocarcinoma en pacientes portadores inactivos. Nos dicen las guías que si hay historia familiar de hepatocarcinoma, pues entonces hay que hacerle el monitoreo y el screening de hepatocarcinoma, pero es muy difícil. En el caso de esta paciente no había ningún antecedente familiar de hepatocarcinoma. Es muy difícil establecer que cuando uno tiene un paciente nuevo de inicio, podamos obtener el dato de antecedentes familiares con hepatocarcinoma. Sigue siendo un reto para nosotros, pacientes de este tipo. Como ven ustedes ahí, no hay datos suficientes para identificar pacientes de alto riesgo de hepatocarcinoma en gente joven o en niños, y lo que recomiendan en las guías es hacer screening si tienen F3 o cirrosis ya establecida. En esta paciente, aparentemente, al momento del diagnóstico, en el 2015, no había diagnóstico de cirrosis. No había biopsia, no había elastografía, así que no lo podemos determinar con certeza. Pero al momento del ingreso con nosotros en el 2017, tampoco hubo ninguna evidencia de cirrosis hepática en ese momento. Entonces, nosotros nos enfrentamos con una gestante muy joven, con una infección crónica de hepatitis B, aparentemente una portadora inactiva, y aparentemente, digo, porque no pudimos tomar histología del hígado, en una paciente con hepatocarcinoma en hígado no cirrótico. Recibió tratamiento con entecavir 0,5 miligramos por día. Darle, creo que entecavir o tenofovir ya en el postparto no cambiaba nada en el curso de esta mujer. Recibe inmunización con inmunoglobulina para el recién nacido y la vacunación anticipada. Y en el caso particular de esta muchacha, se desestimó el tratamiento oncológico con sorafenib porque estaba en un estado general muy malo, tenía bilirrubinas elevadas, desnutrición severa y falleció 6 meses después en el seguimiento postparto. Quiero compartir brevemente una data que nosotros tenemos, por ejemplo, de los pacientes con hepatocarcinoma en el hospital nuestro, evaluado más o menos entre el 2009 y el 2013. El 85% de los pacientes que se presentan con hepatocarcinoma es verdad que se presentan en hígado cirrótico, pero un 15% de ellos se presentan en pacientes no cirróticos. Y de ese 15%, 90% son asociados a virus B. De tal modo que nosotros, en Perú, cuando nos llega un paciente joven con un tumor hepático en aparentemente hígado no cirrótico, casi siempre estamos seguros que está asociado al virus de hepatitis B. Y si ustedes se fijan, 71% de estos pacientes, que suelen ser muy jóvenes, como los que ha presentado también el doctor Paraná, el gran porcentaje de ellos, 71% de ellos son antígeno E negativo, y el 50% de estos pacientes antígeno E negativo tienen una carga viral muy bajita. Nos estamos enfrentando entonces nosotros a pacientes que en apariencia, si yo lo hubiese encontrado incluso antes, probablemente si me guiaba por lo que nos dicen las guías americanas o europeas, solo iba a manejar con monitoreo en este paciente con carga viral y transaminasas probablemente. No sé si eso es suficiente. Este caso lo presento porque es una interrogante para nosotros. No hemos podido resolver todavía ¿qué hacer con estos pacientes? Si de repente buscarles el virus de hepatitis delta que está agravando o haciendo que nos aparezcan hepatocarcinomas en gente muy joven, no lo sabemos realmente, es por eso quizás el motivo de la presentación de este caso, pero los pongo a consideración de todos para que luego seguramente podamos discutirlo. Y brevemente, un segundo caso, porque esto también en países como el nuestro, que pocos recursos, lo vemos con frecuencia. Es un paciente también joven, de 37 años de edad, con diagnóstico ya de cirrosis hepática por virus de hepatitis B en marzo del 2016. Tenía un MEL de 24 puntos, un INR de 1.8, bilirrubinas en 9, creatinina 1.2, varices de segundo y tercer grado por endoscopía, un VIH negativo y la serología de hepatitis B, la que tienen ustedes allí, antígeno de superficie positivo, antígeno E positivo, el anticore también positivo, el anti-E negativo y el anticuerpo contra el antígeno de superficie también negativo. Las transaminasas en 84 y 125, alfa-fetoproteína en 20 y un DNA viral en 35.300 unidades internacionales por mililitro. Aquí no hay probablemente ninguna duda, es un paciente con antígeno E positivo, con una carga viral más de 20.000, transaminasas elevadas, las guías, todas las guías, no tienen ninguna diferencia, hay que tratar a este paciente, así lo hicimos nosotros, iniciamos tratamiento con entecavir, 0,5 miligramos por día, casi un año después el virus, el DNA de virus estaba indetectable, ingresa a la lista de espera que para nosotros es un requisito indispensable entrar con carga viral no detectable y es trasplantado en noviembre del 2017. El motivo de la presentación es probablemente por el hecho de que para nosotros sigue siendo también un dolor de cabeza cuál va a ser la profilaxis para evitar la reactivación del virus B en pacientes post-trasplantados. Esto creo que está cambiando recientemente. El esquema de inmunosupresión que recibió el paciente fue prednisona, basiliximab y tacrolimus. Mantuvo obviamente el tratamiento con entecavir y esto fue algo que decidimos en nuestro servicio y en el grupo de trasplante no administrar inmunoglobulina de hepatitis B en esos pacientes. El manejo más conservador, las guías más conservadoras nos dicen que deberíamos utilizar inmunoglobulina 5.000 unidades en la fase anepática y 5.000 unidades en el post-trasplante. Y en el caso, digamos, en el mejor de los casos, una terapia corta por una semana con inmunoglobulina y mantener el antiviral. Creo que las últimas guías están cambiando. Nosotros esto lo hicimos el año pasado, pero es muy costoso. Administrar inmunoglobulina para países como el nuestro es muy costoso. Nos puede costar a nosotros aproximadamente 20.000 o $30.000 el manejo de la inmunoglobulina en pacientes post-trasplantados, y esto obviamente hace una cosa muy difícil de manejar. Hoy las guías americanas, por ejemplo, establecen grupos de bajo riesgo y de alto riesgo en los cuales uno podría considerar dar inmunoglobulina y en quienes debería considerar no dar inmunoglobulina. Si tenemos un grupo de pacientes de bajo riesgo, aquellos que tienen obviamente el DNA viral indetectable, si tienen ausencia de HIV o de virus Delta, y que obviamente el acceso para los análogos nucleósidos es bueno, estos pacientes podrían obviarse el uso de inmunoglobulina o dar esquemas reducidos de inmunoglobulina. Lo mismo dice la guía europea, aunque la guía europea probablemente es un poco más cauta y plantea usar inmunoglobulina. Yo les traigo el caso para ver qué opinan ustedes. Nosotros hemos decidido en el servicio nuestro, en pacientes de bajo riesgo, con DNA viral indetectable, sin VIH, sin DNA, sin virus Delta, utilizar solo profilaxis con entecavir sin usar inmunoglobulina. Vamos a ver qué nos dice si tenemos riesgo de reactivación en el futuro en estos pacientes, pero los costos, los elevados costos nos están obligando a usar esquemas como estos. Creo que ese es el último caso, la última diapositiva. Les agradezco a todos por su atención y espero que podamos tener algunos aportes en realidad en relación a estos casos que les he venido a presentar. Muchísimas gracias.
So thank you very much for two very interesting patients. Maybe we can start with the second one, which I think is a little simpler. So the major question is, this is a hepatitis B patient with cirrhosis, with a male of 24, put on entecavir, virus DNA suppressed to undetectable, and now it's going for liver transplant. And obviously, I think we'll all agree that we'll maintain entecavir. So the question is, in this particular patient who doesn't have HIV, who doesn't have Delta infection, who doesn't have XCC, but have cirrhosis, being on entecavir with undetectable HBV DNA, would we consider the use of HBAC? And if we do, then how long do we give the HBAC, right? So I'm going to start by saying that in this particular patient, I'll be very comfortable not using HBAC because we know that this patient does not have those high risk factors, the Delta, the HIV, prior antiviral drug resistance, and the DNA has been undetectable and undetectable for a while before the transplant. But we'll see what the fellow panelists think.
David. Yeah, so I think at our institution, we would agree with you that this is a low-risk person for recurrence of hepatitis B. However, we are resource-rich, if you will, and so we would give immune globulin for the first week in the hospital post-transplant and then not continue it, you know, after that.
In English?
Whatever.
En mi opinión, yo creo que nosotros hasta ahora en estos pacientes hemos continuado con entecavir y también con nuestro protocolo de HBIG. Pero es verdad que es muy costoso en los países, de modo que este sería un candidato, y coincido con Ana y David, un candidato ideal para intentar monoterapia con entecavir. Lo que es muy importante también en nuestra región es, si uno hace monoterapia, es asegurar un seguimiento muy cercano del paciente porque si bien es baja la posibilidad que recaiga, si recae hay que rescatarlo, digamos, con otra terapia, asociando o haciendo un switch inmediatamente, porque es un paciente inmunocomprometido.
Raimundo.
Estoy de acuerdo. Nada mal.
Okay.
Nothing to add.
What about you?
Hey, thanks. Again, I'm not going to add anything important, except that for the past 10 years we have not transplanted hepatitis B case. So we're losing our training in hepatitis B. It's going to be nice to see what is the surface antigen kinetics in those patients. At what time after liver transplantation this patient lose the surface antigen, and if it recovers the surface antigen, what to do, no?
So this is very interesting. We see the same thing too. In fact, in the last 15 years or so, with the first availability of oral antiviral lamivudine, within a few years, we begin to see a decline in the number of hepatitis B patients who need a liver transplant. The ones that we see are the ones who were unrecognized hepatitis B. The first time that they were diagnosed, they present with decompensated cirrhosis, and they were too advanced for antiviral to be able to stop the progression, or they were transplanted for liver cancer. So I think that this whole issue about not using hepatitis B immune globulin, initially when the lamivudine came out, we all thought that, well, we can get rid of HBIC. And we realized that we can't, but partly because of the high resistance rate associated with lamivudine. In many countries of the world, and I think some of the best studies came from Hong Kong, because unlike David, they don't have the resources. And the government tends to say, okay, every patient that you transplant, you get a fixed number of dollars, okay? You use it for immunosuppressive therapy or you use it for HBIC. And so they decided they are not going to use HBIC. They had all the patients on entecavir, and they now report 8 years post-transplant. The majority of the, almost all of these patients remain HBV DNA negative, but not surprisingly, because HBIC was not used, some of these patients remain surface antigen positive, which makes some of us a little nervous. I think what happens is, these patients do get reinfection of the liver, that the virus actually seeds the new liver, but the virus replication is being suppressed by the continuation of entecavir. And to alleviate anxiety, they actually did biopsies on these patients 5-6 years post-transplant and show that although they were surface antigen positive, they were DNA undetectable, and the liver biopsy doesn't actually show any evidence of liver injury. So this is in some ways similar to our chronic hepatitis B patients, that we treat them with entecavir, the DNA is suppressed, but they remain surface antigen positive, and over time their outcome is pretty good. Now, of course, I mean, if you have all sorts of resources, you prefer to give them a little bit of HBA, maybe perioperatively, certainly no need for long-term, to give you that sort of comfortable feeling that you clear the surface antigen.
So a question for Anna. So Anna or David, so which are the patients in which now you mandatory recommend both NUCs and HBA?
Well, I think that the late patients that come and they have detectable DNA, they need to be transplanted very quickly, so even though you start them on NUC, the DNA is still detectable on the day that they go into the OR. Those I would want to give them some HBIC. The Delta, because I think that you don't want a surface antigen to be floating around when someone has some Delta, but it's extremely rare for us to see it in North America. There are also some studies that suggest that the patients transplanted for HCC, which is actually a fair number of patients that we transplant nowadays, are a concern because if they do end up with recurrent HCC, there have been some suggestions, although it's not very well proven, that these cancer cells are not as accessible to the oral antiviral or not as responsive. And when patients develop recurrent HCC, even though they have been undetectable for HBV DNA for a while, now all of a sudden they get recurrent B. So that's why patients transplanted for HCC is also considered to be one of those higher risk groups.
Anna, may I ask a question regarding these patients after liver transplantation? There had been several old papers with a combination of antivirals and different types of vaccines, including vaccine with adjuvants, trying to avoid the use of immune globulin. Are vaccines dead?
Well, I think that most of us don't believe that vaccines would allow you to take the patients off antiviral. I see Professor Arroyo sitting in the audience, and the first study actually came from Barcelona group. Remember that many of these studies carefully selected the patients. They have been post-transplant for a long period of time, and they're highly selected patients. The first study was fairly positive, and all the subsequent studies seem to be mostly negative. You have a few patients in home, you might be able to get away. I think majority of us do not feel comfortable, but now with some of the other more potent vaccines, maybe it's something that we can revisit, but I don't feel comfortable at this time. Maybe we should have some time to talk about, you have a comment?
No, just a question, Lee.
Yeah. Because if you have a question, maybe we can take that now, because otherwise we should talk about the first patient.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. The first patient is actually...
I have a question.
Yeah.
For a second.
Oh. The first patient is actually a challenge. And I would say that, initial presentation, this is a young patient. Low DNA, normal ALT. All of us would not be putting the patient on treatment. And it's surprising that the patient will present with liver cancer at such a young age. It's not unheard of, because some studies in Taiwan, they report childhood HCC. The youngest patient I've actually personally seen was 6 years old. And my limited experience is that when kids develop HCC, they tend to be very rapidly progressive. The kids that I've seen, 4 or 5 kids, their liver is like down all the way to the pelvis, and it's enormous. Now, this patient, though, subsequently, when the patient presented, the platelet count was low. So one of the questions was, was this patient truly inactive carrier or someone with inactive cirrhosis? Because if this is inactive cirrhosis, it would be a different story. Anyone with any evidence suggestive of cirrhosis will say, doesn't matter what the DNA is, doesn't matter what the ALT is, you would want to put the patient on antiviral. So, was there any suggestion of cirrhosis initially?
No one.
Nothing.
So if I could comment, because I actually saw a case that was almost identical to yours, but someone who was 34 years old. And we're seeing more and more of these. I practice in an area that is heavily Korean and Chinese. And so a lot of HCC are being picked up by the obstetricians as they're doing screening. And so what we have been doing, although guidelines are guidelines, and they're really just that, guidelines, when a patient initially comes to us, we get the bloods as you described, but we're getting a baseline ultrasound on all of our patients and or a baseline fiber scan on all of our patients. Because as Dr. Locke had said, I think the important thing here is that this patient, you couldn't get a family history, which you would ask, but if there were cirrhosis or bridging fibrosis, that would sort of change. Interestingly enough, the patient that we saw, who was 34 years of age, had the same outcome. You know, she had a C-section, she had a massive tumor, there was nothing you can do, but she was non-cirrhotic. And we tend to see more of these few, but HCCs in these younger patients who are non-cirrhotic.
One of the questions that the first case raises up is the quality of the surveillance. In our country, at least, I cannot talk for the region, but in our country, failure of surveillance with the ultrasound is usually a problem, mainly when the ultrasound is not performed in a specialized and well-trained center. and we have failed. There is Federico probably trying to ask the question to show the experience of the failure with surveillance. Fede? Micrófono. Micrófono, por favor.
Very nice presentation. I'd like to ask the board, what would you think about the PHE score, PAHE score, that was proposed in Europe and validated in Europe for considering those patients who may be or maybe not considered to continue HCC surveillance in HPV patients? Score de PAHE B en pacientes con hepatitis B crónica, considerar el score de PAHE B que está de hecho incluido en la guía europea para considerar a aquellos pacientes que van o no van a screening de patocarcinoma en virus B no cirróticos.
Yeah. I have no idea. No idea.
I don't know.
But I think that the issue about screening, this is the problem in many countries. The first thing is, you have patients who should be getting HCC surveillance, but they're not getting it. Or they may get one or two, and then everyone forget about it. The second thing is, how reliable is the ultrasound interpretation? Whenever we submit a report from North America, and we said it, well, we failed to detect the tumor, the Europeans and the Asians always tell us that's because our radiologists are not so good. Well, it's in part true because in the United States, the ultrasound is done by technicians, and they take a few pictures, and then the radiologists come in and write a report. Now, if the technician didn't really take the right picture, you can't actually see anything and write the report. Whereas in Europe and in Asia, a lot of times the ultrasound is done by hepatologists who actually know the patients, and they probably spend more time doing it. I think that the other problem is we now have so many patients that have BMI of 35 and 40, and we know that if you have 8 inches of subcutaneous fat, that makes ultrasound a lot more difficult.
Yeah, I think that's the exact point, because we've noticed, again, in our country, or our area of our country, a significant difference in quality of the ultrasounds that we get on our patients. But for the most part, the hepatitis B subpopulation, which really tends to be a thinner population than those with hep C or the most common reason, you know, we just see a lot of people with NASH and cirrhosis. We see less false negatives in that population than we do in the others, where the patients are just too large for the ultrasound to be done successfully.
Okay, my personal view is that all patients in this stage, which is HPV antigen negative infection or inactive carriers before, should be followed by ultrasound. You may disagree if it is every 6 months, every 1 year, maybe depending on the fibrosis stage or what the history of the patient, but they should be monitored with ultrasound. Other way, we may have cases like this.
Mainly in these cases in which you suspect that this is a vertical transmission, no? And that probably this lady did have the infection from the very beginning, early in her life.
Yeah, but if you actually input the data into any scoring system, assuming that the platelet count was normal to begin with, you put female sex, you put in very young age, you put low DNA, you put e antigen negative, normal liver enzyme, no family history, there's no way that you come up with a high score. So unfortunately, in real life, sometimes there are these exceptional patients that haunt us. And if we start getting scared because we have one bad patient like this, and we start doing screening on every single one, then it becomes impossible. It really overburdens the system. But we seem to have two questions.
Buenos días, mi nombre es Maciel Cerda de República Dominicana. Respecto al primer caso, me llama la atención varios factores. El estado nutricional de la paciente, él dice que es una paciente con un estado de malnutrición. El ser una paciente HBAG negativo, los pacientes HBAG negativo pueden hacer mutaciones en la región precor y esa mutación llevar a una progresión de la enfermedad. Hacen un fallo hepático o progresan a un hepatocarcinoma. El virus B, por definición, es un virus altamente mutante. Y otro factor es investigar la coinfección con otros virus que le llevan a progresar más rápido. Donde está lo que es una coinfección con virus Delta. Siempre que un paciente virus B progresa rápidamente, ya sea cirrosis o hepatocarcinoma, lo que hay que considerar es si hay una coinfección, o ya sea una superinfección con un virus Delta. Es lo que pienso.
Gracias.
Me corrigen.
Doctora.
Good morning, Raquel from Brazil. I would like to know what is the best approach in non-liver transplant recipients anticorp positive. Monitor or NUX?
Can you repeat it? Non-HCC?
Non-liver transplant candidates. Uh-huh. Renal, heart, transplant recipients, HBC positive.
You mean which are, receive other organs, heart or kidney transplantation?
Yeah.
Okay.
I actually just reviewed this since we started a heart transplant program. So the most recent ASLD HCC guidance document for patients who are going to receive a non-liver, so a heart or a lung, in those patients that are core antibody positive only, the current recommendations are treat, because the risk of reactivation is extraordinarily low, is to put those patients on a nuke for 1 year, monitor the patient, and then stop, and upon stopping, then monitor the patient.
Doctora.
Buenas, Josefa Vázquez, República Dominicana. Mi pregunta es para el doctor Bernstein. ¿Existe algún caso especial en el cual yo deba seguir el paciente por más de un año con profilaxis? O seguimiento por más de un año en el caso de inmunosupresión.
Yeah. So the current recommendations would be no. Yeah, you do not, even in those patients who receive rituximab. So 1 year really should suffice. Hopefully, those patients who ever received that medication will be followed up by their oncologist or whoever provided and follow. But short answer is no. After a year, you should be okay.
So I have a few additional comments because actually this morning I was updating the topic and up to date on hepatitis B and kidney transplant. And I actually co-authored that with my former fellow in Hong Kong who's a nephrologist. And so one of the things is kidney transplant, heart transplant is a little different from liver transplant. With liver transplant, we get the patients down to monotherapy, immunosuppression, fairly early. And rejection is uncommon, so after the first year or so, rarely ever do we need to sort of enhance immunosuppression to treat the rejection. But kidney transplant and heart transplant, oftentimes the patients are maintained on triple immunosuppression for life. And it's not uncommon that even after the first year, they have rejection episodes. And nowadays, they sometimes, when they worry about humoral-mediated rejection, they actually use rituximab as well. So one of the things to be very careful to monitor the patient is whenever the patient needs intensification of immunosuppression, needs some treatment for rejection, then you have to really go back to the beginning and not sort of say, well, we don't need to do anything any longer. With rituximab, we have said that the antiviral prophylaxis should be continued for 12 months after stopping rituximab instead of other immunosuppressant for 6 months. Mm-hmm. But there have been late reports of reactivation occurring as late as 18 months, 20 months after stopping. So it's important to continue to keep an eye. Sometimes it's tricky because you send a patient back to the oncologist and you expect that they'll be following your patients. David is nodding because oftentimes they don't pay attention. They keep checking the blood counts. They don't even check the chemistries. And when the liver enzymes bum up a little bit, they blame on other things. They forget that this patient had a diagnosis of Hep B. When the liver enzymes go up, at least check the Hep B markers and send the patients to us.
So sometimes when I take the patients off antiviral, I wash them for another 6 to 12 months before I wash my hands off.
No, and don't forget that in addition, kidney or heart transplant patients have their own original liver, which is plenty of CCC DNA, so they are different patients.
Tiempo para la última pregunta. Sí, estamos en tiempo para las comunicaciones orales. Flair.
Sí. Neste caso, um caso muito interessante, e sabemos o prognóstico, que em 6 meses a enferma morreu, não? Mas qual é o papel da alfa-fetoproteína, que sabemos que é um fator de prognóstico? Mas nesta enferma, em diagnóstico que tinha cerca de 20 mil unidades de alfa-fetoproteína, qual é o papel dele embaraço, porque ela estava embarazada, ela tinha feto dentro da enferma, e como ha sido a alfa-fetoproteína depois do delivery, ou seja, depois do parto? Javier Ferrer, díganos se tem este dado.
Teníamos uma alfa-fetoproteína 3 meses depois do parto, que estava aproximadamente igual, 17.000, no había una variación mayor.
Yeah, it's actually just to finish one point, which is I usually tell my staff, don't order alpha-fetal protein in pregnant women, because you expect the alpha-fetal protein to be increased as a result of the fetus. Now, of course, in pregnancy would never be 19,000, 20,000. This one, we know that high alpha-fetal protein is poor prognosis, but this one we don't even need them. When you see the scan and it's stuffed full of tumor and the portal vein is invaded, this is really bad. We tend to think that estrogen is protective, and one of the reasons why men are more likely to have HCC than women is postulated to be related to sex hormones. During pregnancy, you have a ton of estrogen, it didn't really protect. So this is really unfortunate. I think we're running out of
Raimundo?
Just a few comments. Regarding the first case, of course, low quality of ultrasonography is usual in our countries, but we have also low quality of HBV DNA. Low quality. Sometimes the blood is collected far from the central lab, and it lost 1 or 2 logs. So we can consider many patients with active disease as inactive. This, the first one. The second, the second point is genotype F. We have no data about carcinogenity of genotype F. No. It should be investigated in our continent.
Well, Brian Mamman thinks that in Alaska, that's associated with much higher risk of HCC. So it's really important to study that in this genotype part of the world. I think that we'll talk to you after that. I think that there's a session following, so we need to stay on time. And I'd like to thank all the speakers, as well as those of you in the audience who participated. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good work.
Most of those that are EN positive have these.